Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 9th meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee in 2017. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets may be used by members during the meeting. We've had apologies received this morning from our Vice Convener, Elaine Smith. She can't make it this morning, unfortunately. And we move to agenda item one, and the committee will take evidence from Margaret Ann Brünjes, Eddie Nelson and Beth Reid. I would normally give you your full titles and organisations, but I thought what would be very helpful for people watching if you said a little bit about the organisation you're representing this morning, and put that on the record before we move to our first question. So thank you everyone for coming along. Margaret Ann, can we perhaps start with yourself?
Sure. Okay, so I work for an organisation called Glasgow Homeless Network. Our home is Glasgow, but we have a number of programmes that work more broadly across Scotland. So we focus on the kind of long and broad kind of perspective. So the root causes and consequences of homelessness and some of the solutions to resolve it. So we don't provide direct services, but we do have an umbrella role in Glasgow.
Thank you very much. Eddie Nelson?
Hi, I work with Churches Action for the Homeless, and we are based in Perth. We cover the Perth and Kinross area. We have different parts of the organisation. We have a floating support team, an outreach team, and are currently a day centre. We have been working in a resettlement field over the last 12 months, and we cover the whole Perth and Kinross area. We look within the Perth area, the Perth city, to carry out, you know, work within the people with other agencies, both statutory and voluntary. But we also cover the wider areas, the rural areas within Perth.
Thank you very much. And Beth Reid.
I'm Beth Reid. I'm Policy Manager at Crisis. We are the National Charity for Homelessness. We work across the UK. And our aim is to end homelessness. We're ambitious as an organisation. We do a lot of research and campaigning. We have skylight centres across the UK, including the Skylight Centre in Edinburgh, which works with about 600 people in Edinburgh and the Lothians. We primarily work with single people. That's a historical thing because of some of the legislation. And we also support rent deposit guarantee schemes across the whole of Scotland, and we've done that for about 10 years.
Thank you very much, and thank you to all of you for being here this morning, for taking the time to say a little bit about your organisations. We'll move to questions now, and we'll open up with a question from Andy Whiteman, MSP.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and thank you for coming along this morning. The committee is just in its early stages looking at the question of homelessness and considering what it might do in this session. So I thought it might be worth just starting with a broad question to ask you what progress, in your view, has been made in tackling homelessness over the past 5-10 years?
Well, if I can start... We obviously had the introduction of the end of priority need, which came into force in 2012, and that was a really major step forward in Scotland and actually internationally in terms of moving legislation on and giving people who are homeless really significant rights to settled accommodation. And I think that's been a major step forward. At the same time, we introduced housing options, and that has helped reduce the number of people who are making applications for homelessness by giving them advice and support and so on. I think that we need to keep up that momentum. I think we need to make sure that we don't rest on our laurels on that. We need to keep going. I think there's lots of changes going on in the wider environment, and particularly around welfare reforms that are making it more difficult for people to sustain their housing and keep their housing costs going. And I think we are seeing some of our cities, we do seem to see more people on the streets for all sorts of reasons, whether that's EU nationals or people with very complex needs. So I think we've made some really good progress, but we need to really keep up that momentum to make sure that it doesn't go backwards. And our aim as an organisation is to see homelessness ended. So we want to really make sure that momentum gets going now and step up that level of ambition.
To that, what progress? We're most definitely exploring all those challenges that Beth Reid was mentioning, but what progress do you feel has been made maybe in the last 5-10 years?
I think progress. I've worked now with the Cath organisation for 20 years. To take it down to a basic level, when I first started 20 years ago within the Perth area, you had 35 to 40 rough sleepers. We now have only 2 or 3, and back to what Beth was saying, a couple of them are EU nationals, and one individual that's his life style choice. So there has been progress made on that side of things. In the last 12 months, again, going back to the housing options and the Perth and Kinross area looking at housing first, homes first model, it has its positives and it has its negatives. What we have is people that are being offered houses and homes, but to a certain degree can't maintain those homes because to a certain extent, you could say they've been institutionalised by going through hostels, temporary accommodation, failing that. But it's also like over 85% of the people that we work to support has chaotic lives, live chaotic lives, and have multiple issues which lead into them having chaotic lives. And what we have is the difficulty in engagement, and that's the biggest difficulty that we face with a lot of these individuals that we work to support. They have sometimes a fear of statutory services and they'll work with the third sector, but we need to look at trying to coordinate better the third sector within the statutory services. So there's a more concentrated, more coordinated effort to work with individuals that slip through the net. We have examples, we do case studies, and we have examples of people that have had, right, for on one occasion, we've had one guy that's in his 60s that's had 6 tenancies over the last 10 years, but he can't maintain a tenancy. But, you know, he then goes back into a hostel situation, he has alcohol issues, he goes back to his own peer group, and then it's a case that, right, he comes through the recovery period, goes back into, he's offered a house, goes back into the house, and then it's a case of the loneliness, isolation, is away from his peer group that used to support him. So therefore he's attracted back to his peer group, which leads him back into the alcohol situation. Yeah. Sorry, I get accused of rambling at times, and it's my first time that I've been here, so you'll have to, you know...
Can I reassure you, as you're saying all of that, we did a discussion about the questions we're very keen to ask, to explore in further detail, and both that you've said is already, Eddie, and indeed Beth, are all questions we're going to explore in much more detail, so you're really helping set the scene for committee members, so you're not rambling at all, you're actually...
But
you're reassuring us that we've got a grasp of the questions we have to explore further. Margaret, Anne, do you want to add anything?
So, I mean, it's actually not often we get the opportunity to ask and reflect on that type of question, because I think when you work in the sector, when you work in the homelessness sector, you're just so kind of deeply working within it, that you don't often have a look back and reflect on all the kind of changes and improvements that have been made. And I think each of us here have kind of worked in this kind of sector for the period that you've described. So there has been significant progress, actually, and the biggest change, as we probably all know in terms of the kind of briefing or your own knowledge, is the legislative advancements that have been made in Scotland. We simply have the best homelessness legislation in the world. Now, what that gives is rights to people, but what that clearly doesn't do is ensure that everybody's able to kind of claim those rights or exercise them, and that's the area within which we're each all operating. I mean, in terms of progress, there was a report published yesterday by Fianza, who are simply a kind of umbrella organisation working out kind of European context, and what they were able to demonstrate that every single country across the European context, with the UK being counted as one, that every single country's homelessness has got worse over the last period, and that the only country whose homelessness hasn't worsened is Finland. And the key difference in terms of what Finland is doing is the Housing First model. But instead of Housing First being considered a model, they've created it as a national strategy and made it a central plank of their whole approach to homelessness, particularly for people with complex needs. And I know this is me now maybe kind of wandering into not a reflection, but more what's next. But if we can definitely have the opportunity to have a chat more about Housing First, I'd welcome that.
Absolutely. Everything you've said, I mean, you've set the scene for what we're going to explore further. Andy, do you want to take some of that forward?
Yes, thanks. Just to echo the convener's comments, we will be following up on all of this detail. So is it fair to say, therefore, that there's been an improvement in broad terms, but that what we're looking at now is greater focus on the complex needs of people, the greater complexity that accompanies preventative work, and possibly some of the complexities that arise when people are in, as Eddie said, in accommodation and not being able to make it. So we've kind of made quite a big stride in tackling the sort of black and white homelessness issue, though more work to do, but more focus on those more complex. Would that be a fair summation of what you're saying?
opinion, yeah.
I think that's fair. I think I would also add in some of the funding challenges that are coming up, particularly around temporary accommodation and the welfare system and how that... So you've got the welfare system, which funds part of homelessness teams in local authorities, but then you've also got the pressures on local authorities more generally, and I think that will be something that needs to be looked at in the wider mix as well.
The proportion of people with multiple disadvantages is increasing, so if homelessness overall in Scotland is reducing in terms of people that make a statutory application to the local authority, we know that the proportion within that, people whose needs are deeper, is increasing, and I think that's why the focus is there, both nationally and locally, because that's the bit we're not doing right, although a number of us have a number of solutions. and again, hopefully we'll get a chance to chat more about that.
Okay, thanks very much. I'll leave it there, but just to say that we're obviously interested in your views on the kind of priorities that we should focus on in the work we do. We're actively considering that, so you have a chance towards the end perhaps to reflect on that, maybe through the session to help us, because it's a big topic, and whatever we want to do, we want to do the most productive work we can. So thank you.
Andy, I'm conscious that one of the things we're looking to explore was housing options, and that came through quite strongly. I wonder if we might tease that out a bit more, just so we can be thematic in our approach to questions. So my understanding, I would like to make sure that we actually understand what housing options actually is, because from our understanding, it's an alternative to traditional homelessness route, where you pitch up and you say to a local authority, I'm homeless, help me. You indicate housing needs and issues and problems in advance, and the local authority or the housing association, the registered social ad, will come around and they'll have a meeting with you to discuss what your options are before you get to the stage of homelessness. It's almost like a semi-preventative measure, if you like. We think that's what it does, but what we're not sure about is when we look at the statistics of those presenting as homeless and those presenting within housing options, is when you compare the outcomes and you compare the numbers, is homelessness actually improving, or are we moving a section of people that otherwise would have presented as homeless, are we actually moving them to another category? Which is fine if that's what we're doing, as long as we're measuring the outcomes for that other category to making sure that the outcomes are better than the traditional homeless route, because if they're the same as the homeless route, they should really be together as the one housing statistic. So I'd appreciate your thoughts a little bit more on how housing options works, and are the outcomes through housing options better than the traditional homeless route? Someone maybe want to? Thank you, Eddie Nelson.
Sorry. Through my experience, the housing options has benefits, and it's what you are touching on there about the preventative work. Our organisation has worked on Perth for 20 years, and the housing options does make a difference, but I think there is grey areas of presenting yourself for homeless. Most of the individuals that we work with, unfortunately, do live chaotic lives. A high percentage are suffering from drug and alcohol misuse issues. And it's difficult for them to build up confidence or to take the step forward, actually stating to, like, for example, going to a housing options team and saying I'm having difficulty with my accommodation, and then support being provided to maintain that accommodation. And there does seem a sense of a lot of our service users, a sense of hopelessness. It's right, I've got a house, but where am I going? What do I do? What support am I being provided within that house? And it feels to me personally that it's not really a coordinated support service, and we need more coordination between both the third sector and the statutory sectors to provide the support. I might be going away a bit off track here. The previously it was like priority, non-priority, and there were certain issues taken into account, and that was done over a, it could be a 15-minute talk with the individual face to face, or when they were approaching the local housing advice centre. And sometimes we have individuals that are very angry b- because of their circumstances, going in and seeking advice. And sometimes their behaviour isn't exactly positive. And at times, I think it's down to the training of frontline staff. There needs to be more training provided and frontline staff on how to deal with these situations and how to try provide the best service to that individual, the best advice and the best options. Am I going off track? Sorry, because
No, it's helpful. I mean, perhaps the issues, but one of mine where I rolled two or three questions together and I should have narrowed it down to the one question. In your experience, Mr. Nelson, but also the other witnesses as well, I'm very curious to know who decides whether someone who is maybe in a private tenancy has 3-4 weeks left to run, they're deeply overcrowded, they've not got a nice landlord, they can't afford the rent, they know they're going to be homeless. Who decides whether that person goes through a housing options route or whether they go through a traditional homelessness route where you're told, right, okay, we'll deal with you that way. It could be a Section 5 referral to a housing association or whatever. In your experience, who decides whether someone is diverted towards housing options or towards the traditional route? What actually happens in practice? I mean, any witness that could give us a steer in that would be quite helpful.
I think there's quite a challenge, quite a tension in the with the legislative approach and the housing options approach. And I think this is kind of quite well known. If you go through the housing options route, are you preventing people from getting their statutory rights through the homelessness system? And I think that is something that's been looked at. The housing regulator looked at that a couple of years ago. There was some non-statutory guidance published last year, which was aimed to kind of look at those issues. But I think that is a tension for local authorities. I think in terms of what happens, I would imagine in that situation that you described, it depends whether somebody's got a notice to quit and then at what point they intervene. I think what we're seeing, certainly in the areas that we work in our Skylight Centre, is that there are a lot of pressures on the local authority, and actually if people go to the council, quite often they're being told, well, actually, you've got a three-hour wait, you can hang around, we might be able to see you in the end of the day, but we might not, or you can come back a bit later. And actually people are quite often being discouraged, whether deliberately or not, from presenting at an early stage, and it's not until they actually are homeless and they have been kicked out by the landlord that they actually have to go to the help, and at that point they're in crisis and they need something in an emergency, and that's where it becomes much more difficult to help somebody.
That's very helpful. Do local authorities count the statistics in relation to that? Because what I'd be keen to know, for example, in Glasgow would be, for every person that turns up to say, I'm homeless now, as in I'm on the street, but they could also be their sofa surfing or they're about to be chucked out their private let for whatever reason, does anyone collect the data to say, well, in any given day we have 20 presentations of which 10 are told to come back once they're homeless, or 10 are told to go to for a housing option? Is anyone collecting the data so we can analyse what's actually happening across Scotland?
There is an awful lot of data collected. We have the HL1 statistics, which is whenever somebody makes a homelessness application. We also have the Prevent1 statistics, which is when anybody comes to housing options. I think, again, looking at the experience of our Skylight, you know, we have worked with clients who have said, well, I went to the council and I told them that we're homeless. And I'm not just talking about Edinburgh Council, I'm talking about, you know, we work in the wider area. We've been to the council, we said we were homeless, and they didn't get any help. And then we go back and say, well, has this person made a homelessness application? Because they think they have. And it turns out that it hasn't been accepted as that. So I think, you know, there's lots of data collected, but how that's collected, the variations in that between different areas, I think is questionable.
Margaret Anne, yes.
Yeah, I mean, the Glasgow context is that the experience you describe is less likely to happen if somebody go through the housing options route than if somebody goes through a direct homelessness route. So that would mean, you know, can maybe showing up at a local casework team. Although if somebody does show up at a local casework team, that type of data is more likely to be collected. And now this is the Glasgow context I'm talking about, and it's more likely to be collected as a result of kind of voluntary intervention of the Scottish Housing Regulator, and I need to better understand the full extent of homelessness, people who are making homeless applications, people who are attempting to, as well as people who are getting a decent service.
I mean, I wouldn't dwell on housing options too much. It might be that the witnesses we have in front of us today, that your three organisations are dealing with vulnerable people when a lot of this system breaks down. Mm. So maybe you're the step beyond housing options or beyond the statutory homeless route where things have broken down and you're providing other kind of voluntary forms of support. Sorry, Beth Reid.
Yeah, I just wanted to kind of make a more general point about housing options. And I think looking at the data that we've got, what seems to be going on is that housing options tends to be primarily advice and information. If you look at the data that's collected, about two-thirds of it at least is just telling people about their homelessness rights or just giving them general housing advice. And I think that the approach to housing options that you described at the beginning sets out something that should be more than that. So it should be more, it should be looking at, you know, can we negotiate with the landlord and get them to rethink this notice to quit? Can we look at getting some repairs to the house? Can we do some mediation with the family if a young person's been kicked out? So, you know, it can be much more in depth than we're doing at the moment. I think also looking at other housing options. So, you know, in some parts of the country, we have a long wait to get into social accommodation. Are we looking at the private rented sector? We know, for example, in Fife and Dundee, we get 300 people a year into private tenancies. In other parts of the country, there's very, very few people going to private tenancies. And that can be, for some people, that can be a really good option. It's not always right for everybody. But we need to look at housing options much more widely, and not just give advice and then pass them on. I mean, half of people who go through housing options end up making a homeless application. So can we look a bit more in depth and find different options? And we also know that there's huge variations around Scotland. So some local authorities are doing it really well and some are much lighter touch.
And I'd like to support that point and also maybe just make the kind of comment that we were talking earlier about Scotland's leading reputation in some aspects of homelessness, and actually one of them has been the housing options approach, and actually the public sector's leadership role within that. And it's an opinion I make everywhere, and it's not always popular, but it's true. In terms of Scottish and national government and local government, there was a leadership role that completely changed how we prevent and tackle homelessness at a local level, and that's to be absolutely applauded, you know. But what we would say next is to the public sector, within each of the, particularly the housing options hubs, is it's time now to bring the third sector in. Because I think exactly as Beth is saying, if we're looking at the need to achieve a greater range of prevention activity, to go deeper into communities and reach more complex people, then that's going to need the kind of skills and the experience that the third sector has. And I think there's a lot of frontline services that are just desperate to be invited in.
Okay, that's very interesting, and I have to say we're unclear, particularly in how housing options work, which is why we're asking these questions. And that final comment there, Margaret, and it seems to be as if there could be a lot of successes with it, but unless you're consistently monitoring and assessing what the outcomes look like, it's hard to evidence-base that, and it's also hard to evidence-base when things are not working as they should be, and it could be working differently across local authorities. I mean, I don't want to ask any more questions on housing options, but I don't know, Alexander Stewart wanted to add one or two things on that.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I think you've given us a very good overview of where we are. And I think that the visits we had gave us a flavour of what you're dealing with. But one area you talked about was a coordinated approach, having that coordinated approach. Now, when we went to Perth to the Church of Acts for the Homeless, you talked about at times that there was a discord sometimes between the local authority and yourself, depending on how that was managed with the client or the service user. And that sometimes what you were providing or suggesting was something that the local authority didn't provide, or they gave them a house when your advice was maybe they should be looking at other options. I found that quite complex, that, you know, that we were all trying to work to achieve one goal, but it wasn't being achieved for the actual service user. And the advice from yourselves as a third sector organisation was sometimes being challenged or not taken on board by a local authority. And I'd like maybe to expand on that, because we do know that there's a variation across Scotland and local authorities as to how they tackle this. And I think communicating with the service user who maybe has literacy or numeracy issues, I think is also an area that needs to be looked at when you're talking about training and skills. So that's something I'd like to maybe expand with you.
Excuse me. Yeah, I agree. We have individuals that we've supported for over the 20 years, Mr. Stewart, and those individuals have been provided with tenancies and not been able to maintain those tenancies for whatever issues that they have. And it's trying to work with issues. For example, if an individual arrives and they've got four presenting issues, one could be mental health, one could be drug addiction, and two other issues. And what do you focus on? And what the focus has been on and what has developed as a focus is a house. Housing first. If you get the stability within the housing, then they could start addressing the other issues that would hopefully maintain and sustain that tenancy and get them back into recovery and move forward. But what we're finding is that the tenancy, being allocated the tenancy, and the process of going through that allocation of the tenancy causes more stress for that individual. Therefore, that could be a trigger for them not completing the recovery and taking two or three steps back, unfortunately. So it's back to the tenancies. It's housing, the choices. If you look at choices for someone presenting, and we have individuals that's now staying in Ailith, Blairgowrie, Kinloch Rannoch, which is a widespread area of Perth and Kinross, as you know. Now, their idea was all of those individuals that are now living in those areas were going through recovery processes. And they thought, right, that's a rural area. I'll get peace. Nobody will, you know, have a perception of me having this habit or that habit. I'll go there. I'll get, I'll be anonymous. I'll be able to be part of the community and try to develop my relationships with the community. But they find once they're there, they're not then associated with their peer group that used to be supportive. Even if it was a negative manner, they were still supporting that individual. So therefore, they're drawn back into Perth. They don't maintain their tenancy. They're not provided with the level of support that they need. And that's their choice. They're thinking that that's a good choice, and it's not really a good choice because it's explaining through the, you know, the housing. It's right, you're wanting to move to Ailith, it's a rural area. Do you know the transport costs? Do you know that maybe the petrol will be a bit dearer? Do you know maybe the milk and bread will be a bit dearer? Do you know you need a new doctor? That's my way of sitting down with someone and trying to explore where they would like to move to. And sometimes that's a countermeasure. We do have difficulties at times with the local council because they have targets to meet. And it's like what you were talking about earlier, is what's an outcome? Is it a number? Yep. Is it an individual? Is it the amount of houses that's been allocated? And that's where I feel that the grey area, and there's still difficulties, is that I think the agencies are now looking, and the government is now looking at outcomes as true outcomes. How do you move someone on? It's not just, oh, we've worked with 40 people, oh, we've housed 30 people. It's what happens when they're housed. And I think there needs to be more investigation, more support, and more research carried out on the journey of an individual. Like I was explaining earlier, we had one individual in his 60s that's went through 5 tenancies in a short period of time that cannot maintain those tenancies. In my opinion, it would be good to sit down with that individual. And we do have, you know, support workers that have a good positive relationship with the individual and find out the history. It's back to what is the triggers for the housing failing, and then trying to work on new models of accommodation. What we have at the moment is, you know, your peer homelessness, you could be allocated a place in a hostel, temporary accommodation, maybe move on to temporary accommodation, which was old model, and then into secure accommodation. And there's difficulties in that process too. There was positives and there was negatives. The positives was you presented as homeless, you were allocated a place in the hostel, you paid a service charge of a certain amount, and you were provided with your meals, you were provided with accommodation, the TV license was paid, the gas and electricity was paid, you had a room. Your next stage would be possibly temporary accommodation. That was basically furnished, but it was habitable, and you were provided support with that. And then move on to secure accommodation. As soon as you hit the secure accommodation, that's it. You're possibly £70 benefits. And these people are living chaotic lives. They then had to start dealing with their utility bills. They had to start dealing with TV licence. They had to start looking at what they get furnished as the bed. And that's a process. And the process then goes back to the individual and us as support workers applying for community care grants. So a person's allocated a house. And this, at this moment in time, we could have individuals that's got to make a decision on where they accept that tenancy or not accept that tenancy in hours, rather than days or weeks, but in hours. So there's a certain pressure and stress level in having to take that tenancy on, even though they maybe feel, oh, this isn't really the place I want to stay, but I need to take it because I'm not going to have another option to take another choice. And it's all a combination of factors, and that's what I go back to looking at. There needs to be a coordinated effort, a discussion to take place. And the question, sorry, I'm rambling again. The question you were saying, Mr. Stewart, is that what happens, I feel, is that it's, right, there's a house, that's a tick box, that's your way you've got there. We'll try to provide support, but there's not enough resources to provide the support in the statutory sector, in the public sector, and it comes back to the third sector. And it's not about, you know, the third sector, I find it difficult to explain. It's the statutory sector's there, and they make the decisions, and to a certain extent, they hold most of the power. Correct. And they hold a lot of the purse strings too, whether it's central government, local government. For example, Churches Action for the Homeless, we are funded through service level agreements on a 12-month basis. So every year, comes Christmas, we've got workers that are becoming demotivated. Where do we get? And I'm sorry going on for this, but this impacts on the housing models. Become demotivated, I'm going to look for another job. We go back to the Christie report in 2011, I think it was over 50%, they did this research, over 50% of people working in the third sector were looking at other employment, moving out because of the stress levels, anxiety, not knowing where they're going to be in 12 months, 18 months. So it comes back to the longer terms of funding to be able to provide the support for the individuals that we work with, which unfortunately are the most chaotic, to provide a level of support over a longer period of time with a continuity that you've got time to develop a relationship with those individuals, to build up the trust, to build up the honesty, to take that stage forward. Again, back to your point, is that what they have is they maybe see these individuals that's presenting for homelessness once or twice, and then they're saying, right, we're offering you this house. And we go back to them and say, well, that's not going to work. This guy or this person will most likely fail this tenancy in a short period of time because of the environment, because of the issues that they're having. And we're basing that judgment on working with that person over a long period of time, sometimes 5-7 days a week. So we're developing a relationship. We're seeing their habits. We're seeing the issues. We see how they react in certain circumstances. And that's what we're trying to put forward. That's our opinion that this will happen. But I think because of the targets, and it's not just Beth and Kinross, it's all over, that's it. And that's coming back to, again, the figures, what is working and what's not working. There needs to be more researched how to look at things. How do we come up with outcomes? What outcomes are we actually achieving? You know, an outcome for our organisation, our worker, is going in and monitoring somebody and seeing that they're still alive. And that is basic, and it's not harsh. That is what the situation is, because that's the difficulty that we have.
Okay, that's very...
Sorry.
No. I'm going to bring you in a second, but I want to reassure you, because within that, I think you made a very valid point about secure longer-term funding for non-statutory services that are effective and providers who are effectively bolstering the statutory system in the way that you outlined pretty eloquently, I have to say. So the committee's heard that, and that's an official report. The other thing I'd written down is ongoing support and advocacy for individuals with complex support needs, irrespective of whether it's a housing first model or a housing options model. It's about building trust and relationships with those individuals over the longer term. And I think that's pretty much what you were saying, Mr. Nelson, in relation to that. And none of that was rambling. I think it put pretty eloquently the support that your organisation and others provide. So thank you for that. Margaret Ann, did you want to add?
There is just something so specific in all of that, actually. Something so specific also, in addition to what you just paraphrased, in terms of how we approach the systems change that we need to undertake over the next phase. Now, if we put to one side people suffering as a given and focus on us who work in the sector in all our different roles across all the different kind of sectors and our seeming often obvious inability to properly work together in a truly trusting and respectful way. Now, there are examples of it happening, and where it happens, they see the goods, they see what happens, you know, what outcomes happens, but it doesn't happen often enough.
Just come in on that. I think we have an incredibly complex environment of services. So we have, you know, a homeless service, we have a social work service, we have the NHS as a different body, we have all of these services, and then we commission out. So the homelessness service might be divided between 10 homelessness voluntary organisations as well. So we've got an incredibly complex environment. And then we've got one individual in the middle of that with a whole range of needs, which may be complex or may just be ordinary needs, but they do need, you know, a bit of confidence. They do need a bit of support with, you know, been feeling low because they're in a bad housing situation, that they're struggling with their employment. Not necessarily complex needs, just a variety of needs, although some people will have extremely complex needs on top of that. And it's how do we look at the individual across all of these different services and make that the focus. I think in terms of some of your points about partnership working, you know, I think there is some really good stuff out there. And you know, Glasgow Homelessness Network has a coordination role in Glasgow. There's the SHAPE organisation in Edinburgh, which coordinates all the third sector homelessness organisations. But it is challenging. And, you know, the points about funding, really, really important. Crisis is a non-commissioned service. We're very, very lucky in that respect. But, you know, when we've moved into new areas, setting up a service, you know, there is a sense of, well, who are these people? Are they going to threaten our funding? All of these kinds of questions. And then they realise that we are there genuinely to work in partnership and to contribute and add value to what's already there. But there is that constant threat. And I think charities who are funded by local councils are in a difficult position sometimes also to challenge. You know, it can be difficult saying to a council, actually, you that have this number of people and you're not helping them when you're dependent on them for their funding next year.
Thank you.
Traditionally, the roles across the different sectors have been adversarial, you know. But the truth is, if your starting point is that nobody's doing this deliberately, if you work in homelessness, nobody's doing this deliberately. Therefore, everyone, no matter what role they're in, are doing the best with what they have. And then, in my opinion, what you need to look at is what we have, what it is that we're working with, and what it is going to allow us to put the pieces together to find the right solutions.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Alexander. Thank you very much. Graham Simpson.
Thanks. I think it follows on from everything you've said, but I'd also like to go back to something that you said earlier, Margaret Ann. You mentioned Finland. I was very interested in that. You said that was the only country in the world where homelessness hasn't increased, but they have a national strategy. I guess my question to all of you is, do you think Scotland should have a national homelessness strategy? I think in Crisis's written evidence, you suggested that should be the case. You also mentioned things that are going on in Wales. So I wonder if you could expand on that. So a couple of questions, national strategy and what is going on in Wales.
Thank you. And if... you hear me? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, sorry. To make my point clearer, that the Finnish experience is that their national strategy is housing first, not that they have a national strategy per se. So that their approach has been where other countries, and including Scotland, have looked at, for example, housing first as a project localised, that instead they've taken a strategic countrywide approach to housing first, and that's their strategy, although they may indeed have other strategies. In terms of the need for a national strategy in Scotland, my sense is we would have to be absolutely clear what the purpose of it is. If some of the spirit of housing options has been about enabling and empowering local partners to come together to find local solutions to local problems, and if it's said that homelessness is something that originates always locally, it doesn't come from anywhere else, then sometimes national strategies can serve to not underpin but overrule sometimes local approaches that are working well. Not always, it would depend what's in them. If the point is about consistency, I think I would always kind of note too that clearly consistency doesn't always mean better. Consistency is only better if it's better, you know. And often the need to have a national strategy serves the purposes of organisations, I guess, who want an easier job of monitoring and evaluating outcomes. And not that that's a bad thing, of course. For me, I haven't been entirely convinced yet that a national strategy would properly direct resources and energies to something better and more, if it was an overall strategy, and more what I would like to see as the next movement being, similar to what the 2012 movement was being, is a housing first movement. So something that just has an absolute focus and not something that on a national aspect encourages to look at all the different elements of homelessness, which we know are significant, and when instead they can be better addressed at local level.
I can say, just make a few points about various of those things. I think Finland's really interesting. As Maggie says, it's got a strategy around housing first. But I think, so what they've tried to do is tackle very complex homelessness, so people who've been living on the streets and so on. For me, one of the key things about that is that everybody bought into that. And I think that's one of the lessons of the 2012 agreement as well. You know, everybody bought into this idea that we are going to end priority need. In Finland, everybody bought into this idea, local authorities, national government, people, other agencies at local level, that we're going to tackle this. And that's what I think is really important. And there's a number of other areas, countries where they've developed plans around ending homelessness. So Canada is another one. The USA has done some really interesting work on that. So in terms of a national, I think, I'm not sure whether the word strategy is always helpful, but I think there's something about a national ambition to end homelessness. And that's something that Crisis is looking at developing over this coming year. We've got a conference that I mentioned in our evidence on the 15th of May in Glasgow. And what we want to do there is begin to kickstart that process. What do we need? What would it look like to end homelessness? First of all, what does that mean? Does that mean no rough sleeping? Does that mean no sofa surfing? Does that mean nobody ever moves on from somewhere with nowhere to go? What does that look like? And then thinking about, well, what do we need to do that? And what does that mean at national level? What does that mean in terms of services working together? But I think absolutely critically what Maggie says, what does that mean at local level? Because it will look different in Perth from how it looks in Edinburgh, from how it looks in Wick, from how it looks in Inverness. It will look different. So what does that mean and what does that look like? How do we engage the public in that? You know, there's a whole range of questions in there. And I think from our perspective as Crisis, you know, that is something that everybody has to buy into. It's not something that just has to be done by Scottish Government or by local authorities, but it's something that we all need to buy into. And I think critically also, it's not just something for housing and homelessness. It's, you know, a lot of the issues that we're talking about, social care issues or health issues or employment issues. So it's a much broader thing. But in order to tackle what is the outcome of some of those I don't mean failures in terms of services doing a bad job, but somebody losing their job or a relationship breakdown. The end outcome is homelessness, but actually the starting point is a lot further down, a lot earlier upstream. So how do we? So I think when we're talking about a national approach, that is that kind of ambition in particular that we want to focus on. Just to come in on Wales. So Wales introduced the Housing Wales Act 2014. So what they've done there is, I think they looked at the Scottish model and felt the ending priority need was perhaps almost too ambitious for them. But what they have done is they've created this dual duty, which is a prevention and a relief duty. So there is now a duty on local authorities to take action to prevent homelessness from happening in the first place if somebody is 56 days away from homelessness. And then if they are if they do become homeless, even as a result of that, then there's duties around relieving homelessness, which is kind of like some of the duties that we've got. I think one of the differences is that kind of statutory duty to prevent homelessness, which is kind of there in the Scottish legislation, in that if you're threatened with homelessness within 56 days, then you should be able to make a statutory homelessness application. But I think it creates quite a clear journey through the system. And I think one of the really interesting things that they're using is personal housing plans, and that gives people a really clear route through the system, so that they know that if they these are the steps that they need to take, these are the steps the local authority need to take. If that doesn't work, these are the next steps, and these are the next steps, and that can be reviewed and looked at. And I think that helps create a really clear journey through the system. And Crisis convened an expert independent group in England recently, which was chaired by Suzanne Fitzpatrick from Heriot-Watt University. And they developed a model for England, which they felt would work, drawing largely on the Welsh model. And that is actually reading, that was presented as a private member's bill, and that's actually reading its receiving its final reading in the House of Lords tomorrow, and that will, we hope that will get royal assent in the next few weeks. And that draws on that. So that has the prevention aspect, the relief aspect. And also critically, I think, a duty for other public bodies to refer on. So if they identify that there's somebody at risk of homelessness or facing homelessness, they have a duty to refer to the homelessness service within the local authority. So that means that you capture people at that much earlier stage. And that's something we've actually seen in Edinburgh in our work. So we've been doing some really good work with a couple of the job centres. And one of the things we've got them to do is just say to people, are you facing homelessness? And they've been really surprised at the number of people saying, well, actually, I'm really worried about this. I think I might be facing homelessness in the next few weeks. And then we can begin to act early, and we can begin to get people at that early stage, prevent homelessness, negotiate with the landlord, whatever that is. And it also helps everything else. It helps the job centre to get them into employment, because they're no longer worried about their housing situation. They can actually focus on that. So I think there's some really interesting models that lessons that we can learn from the Welsh system about having a consistent approach through the system, and also making sure that people approach services early enough.
Yeah, I agree with that. If we look at the kind of technical legal aspect solely, then we already have the Welsh prevention duty within the Scottish legislation, if that makes sense. To all intents and purposes, it's the same. The 56 days, we have that. The duties that a local authority owes somebody that's homeless start 56 days before that person becomes homeless, which is the same as the Welsh duty to all intents and purposes. Now, the truth is, again, how that's implemented is quite different. So that being the focus of the Welsh duty means that probably, arguably, they'll achieve more and within the 56 days than we will, because it's a different kind of approach. So I suspect if Scotland was wanting to look to legislate round about prevention, it would be looking to something I would suspect that would be longer than 56 days or more than what's within the Welsh duty.
To follow on from that, I think there is a complexity in the Scottish legislation which means that you get the right to relief when you're almost preventing the homelessness, and that's where some of the tensions come in, I think. I think that is where the challenges come in for housing options teams.
Yeah. Eddie, you don't feel obliged to answer, but I would love to hear from you if you want to add something to that.
I think, speaking to the colleagues, or listening to the colleagues here, it's back to the coordination. It's like, you know, we make suggestions that there's quite a lot of elderly population now in Perth and Kinross Council, high percentage, and they suffer from loneliness and isolation, so we're always looking at building up groups. But they have home carers, they maybe have Macmillan nurses going on. That's something that you touched on, Beth. If we could get information out, that we receive information in, all the services receive information, it's more coordinated, but there's better communication. And that can be difficult because of the number of services that's involved. But I think the important factor is the communication. Down in England, like in the rough sleeping counts, they have a computer system data that's collected. So a member of the public could say, I saw this guy, age 40, standing on this corner of this town, looked like he was having difficulties, and then some of support services pick up on that. And that's what we're trying to encourage within communities, and that's what the Scottish Government's doing, putting forward the policies, they're looking about inclusiveness, integration. And until we properly integrate the services, where it's the third sector coming and playing a part with the statutory services and vice versa. It's not about somebody taking the lead or somebody, you know, saying, right, we'll follow that. It's about all the services, the mental health services, NHS. And I know they're trying to achieve that at the moment, and it's sort of partway there through the integration of healthcare and social care. But it's getting the communication. The important thing is the communication. I don't think the communication is there at this moment in time because there's too many services. And to a certain extent, in my experience, that people are under pressure to carry out those services with individuals. Like, you've got to support that a number of people in this period of time. And therefore, there's not enough time spent with individuals. For example, they're talking about Wales and Finland. There's projects starting down in England now. And sorry, I'm not harping on it. It's like they're called Fulfilling Lives. And it's a partnership work between the statutory sectors and the third sector. They've set up teams to work with people that's living chaotic lives, that has the highest percentage of reoffenders, drug misuse, alcohol misuse, and they're not engaging and they're sleeping rough. And it's mainly funded through the lottery funding, but it's a partnership from the local government and the councils with the third sector, and have applied to lottery funding. I think there's eight places in England that was received between, I think it was 6 and 10 million, but they looked at it over the longer term, so it's for a 5-year period. So they're giving them a substantial amount of time to develop the relationships, look at the issues, and try to work as a team to develop that. At the moment in time, you know, not just with housing, it's a situation, if we have someone that presents with mental health issues, first stage is the GP, the doctor. Some won't attend the GP. Then it's maybe a referral on, or it's maybe going through the drug and alcohol team. So it's maybe our staff, CATH staff, that are going with them to support them and advocate on their behalf. But if it's possible, I would like to submit some case studies that are collaborative routes to recovery have done over the last 12 months. It was funded through the Integrated Health and Social Care. And it's maybe small barriers to us at how we deal with, like, personally, if I'm phoning up about my Eon bill, I get very frustrated that I've got to press button one, button two, button three, button four, without speaking to a person. You know, can we magnify that with someone that has literacy and numeracy issues, that has difficulty, get very, very angry, possibly say the wrong word over the line, and that gives the person on the line an excuse to put the phone down? And it's about, you know, what we call in the CATH, if we are advocating on behalf of someone on the phone, they are dealing with our benefits sanction, and we, non-verbal communication, we're usually sitting at the other end of the desk going, no, cut it, don't say those words, you're going to get... And it's small things like that, but these have huge impacts on these individuals. And it's we talk about integration and trying to integrate. You know, we've got people that's in communities, and if we have an individual that's allocated a house, a home in a community that already has these issues, that's trying to recover from those issues, goes into that community, and 9 times out of 10, and it's just human nature at this moment in time, that a lot of that community will pick up on that person's issue, and that person's going to be stigmatised and persecuted from the start. So we have to look at the whole model if we were doing what we're going. Like, this, you know, what's happening in Persic and Ross, there's success. There's areas that were deprived, there's areas that were stigmatised, that, you know, the people's perception or the public's perception was, oh, no-go areas. And what you see now is homes being built. They're beautiful homes that our communities are starting to come together. You've got the new school, and that's what we need to do, I think, personally. And it's, sorry, again,
I'm going to interject only because, actually, I really don't want to interject. I'd rather just let you continue to speak, because you've actually answered a whole set of questions that we haven't asked yet, and you've put it very well on the record. No, but in relation to how health services have to engage with the voluntary sector and the statutory sector and get things right, I'm only interjecting because I know members have got questions to raise.
Yeah, my apologies.
Please don't apologise, because it's worth its weight in gold, some of the evidence you're putting on the public record here today. So my apologies to yourself that I have to kind of cut you off there, and I'm sorry about that. Graham, before I move on, do you want to follow up on any of that, and then I'll wait at Ruth Maguire in afterwards?
It's really quick, convener, because I know there's a lot more we want to ask. Thanks for your answers there, because there's an awful lot for us to look at out of that. Just a very quick question to Beth. You mentioned there's a bill going, getting its final reading in the Lords. What bill is that?
That's the Homelessness Reduction Bill. So that is a bill that will introduce prevention and relief duties in England. As I said, this duty around services cooperating. I can provide you with more information about that if you want.
Okay. Lovely.
Could I just make a very quick point about culture of services? And I think that there is something really important about the culture of services. I mean, I think we're seeing it at the moment with health and social care integration. You know, there's a real challenge there. I think we see it between the third sector and the statutory sector. But I also think it's something that we see between, and I think this goes back to some of the points that Maggie's been making, between statutory homelessness provision and housing options. And I think housing options brought in a very different culture. And I think that has been a challenge for local authorities to take up. So instead of, you know, going through this very set route and, you know, is this person eligible, is this person not eligible, to looking at what can we do to help this person? It's a very different culture, and I think there's something really important in that we need to look at and address. And I think perhaps that's why housing options has been so variable. And I think perhaps where some of the things you're raising about, you know, the legislative route versus the wider kind of system of support come in.
Options instead of being a binary, it is about options and appraisals of those options, and that's been challenging, I think, for a number of organisations within our sector, I think, in the third sector as well. But it's whether what we want is to prevent homelessness or prevent a homeless application, and what housing options can do is prevent homelessness. Yeah.
That's really helpful. Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to move on to rough sleeping. The committee was interested in the topic. There was a question around whether it was increasing or it was just more visible. We heard from Shelter that there has been a rise in rough sleeping, and Tony Kane from Alacho agreed. He expressed two concerns, the first one being that some of that was people just simply walking away from statutory services, and that the second one was about economic migrants perhaps not having access to public funds and ending up on the streets. So I have a couple of questions. Do we know enough about why it occurs? Why does it occur? And is it increasing? So I'd be interested to hear your reflections on those points.
In short, do we know enough is no. I think from our experience in Edinburgh, a lot of the people that we see rough sleeping do have complex needs. Some of them have not engaged with statutory services for whatever reason. That might be because they've had bad experiences in the past, either in the local area or elsewhere. It might be because the kind of needs that they've got, if they've got mental health problems and so on, they may not feel that they want to engage. And some may have been turned away by the local authority, and we certainly know that there are real challenges of providing temporary accommodation in Edinburgh in particular. And you know, if you go to the council, if you go by 10 o'clock in the morning, they might well have run out for that day. So there is a challenge there. But I think there is a lot of complex needs. I think there's also a lot of EEA nationals who may not be entitled to benefit support, and that can pose a challenge. In terms of what we know, the data that we collect is about whether people present to the local authority, so that only gives you a kind of relatively narrow picture, and we don't know about the people who don't present. It is definitely becoming more visible. I think certainly in I would think Edinburgh and Glasgow in particular, that I think there probably has been a rise, but I think it's very difficult to say because we don't have any other figures apart from whether people turn up to the local authority. We do know the shelters have been full the last couple of years.
Probably with a bit of confidence just to Glasgow in kind of context, but not any wider than that, for all the reasons that Beth says, that there isn't a common monitoring approach. So it's based on kind of different opinions and perspectives and different counts, really. But within the Glasgow context, GHN operates a common monitoring system, which is a shared online case management system, that a number of the key high volume, low threshold services in Glasgow use. The last annual data we had was obviously 15-16, because we'll be doing our next annual report over the coming weeks, and it was able to demonstrate an 18% increase in rough sleeping in Glasgow on the previous year. So we're able to say with confidence that the numbers have gone up, but on top of that, what we're seeing in Glasgow is visibility increasing. And there's a number of anecdotes and discussions around about why that might be, because what we're seeing on the streets in Glasgow isn't proportionate to the figures increase, but there is definitely a cultural change in people's willingness, courage, to sleep more publicly. There was always the kind of take in Glasgow that people would hide away because it was safer, particularly over the kind of weekend evenings, and that you were safer to be under a bridge or down a lane than you would be in a shop doorway. Contrary to, you know, other cities where people felt maybe safer in more public areas. So there has been a a mode of coming out, in a sense, and people more willing. Some of the discussions around about that in the Glasgow context has been that some of the other expressions of street activity, for example, begging, which is often but not always, as we know, associated with homelessness, and some begging activity that takes place in the city of Glasgow is undertaken by particularly Roma community, I think maybe the Romanian, maybe Latvian, and because that is a much more public expression, there's almost a sense that there's a kind of following of suit, you know, that if there's a willingness to be more public with begging and sleeping, then people are coming out in the corners. So an increase in visibility as well as an increase in numbers is what the take in Glasgow is.
Excuse me, Beth and Ross, numbers are low. As I think I mentioned before, at this moment in time, there's three or four, a couple of them are European nationals and a couple of individuals that prefer that as their choice. We still advise them and advocate on behalf of them accessing food banks or benefits and things like that. But it has, from about 2 months ago, 20 years ago when I first started with Cath, there was between 30 and 40. It's different nature of things. Now, like up, Chris, I would say about 12 months ago, there was maybe about 8 of those individuals, and they didn't want to access accommodation. But what's happened is because of the person kind of stance on the Homes First model, that people are being offered accommodation. What you're finding, instead of sleeping rough, they're sleeping on their friend's sofa, or they're sleeping in the spare room. So it's gravitating that way. They've still not got accommodation, but they're just going round about their friends or their peer group who, was allocated a tenancy. Some of the difficulties of people that's allocated tenancies is what we call the sofa suffering, is that they then concern that the intimidation is high. We have an individual that's maybe, for example, has a drug issue, invites his friends in, people get to hear about that, and then some of the others of the local community go in and use it as a shooting up gallery, basically. And that puts that person's tenancy at risk. We then get concerns raised by the local housing officers. We try to go and support that individual. And then it could be a case of, well, yeah, right, we can move things forward. We'll support you to maintain that tenancy. But when that support's left, the peer group move back in. So it's a continuous, and that's what we find is some people are then presenting as homeless, saying that we can't maintain the tenancy. It's then, well, you're intentionally homeless, so we can't offer you anything. So then we try to step in, and that's what you were speaking about earlier, Mr. Stewart. We try to advocate on the behalf and saying, well, they can't maintain the tenancy. Can we look at different models of accommodation? And if that means accepting that you'll be in a hostel for a period of time, but you've got an individual room, you've got support, you've got your heat and lighting, etc., it's a step forward. Yeah. But it's also what I'm trying to put forward is the models of accommodation. We need different models of accommodation. A house doesn't fit everybody. A house isn't suitable for everybody. Where it's because of their issues, because of the peer group that run about with it. And it's also about what we were talking about earlier, about the integration within a community. And to integrate in a community, to a certain extent, you need to be accepted in that community and contribute something to it. But it's a two-way story. Perth and Ken Ross, we do have individuals that's begging. Every individual that is begging on the streets has accommodation. We have got issues with non-engagement with those individuals. They put it down to their previous experiences with services. But again, it's down to their issues. And what they're trying to do is they can make more money from begging than off their benefits. And again, that's part of, again, I'm going back on about things, sorry, and I'm maybe going away off again on tangent.
I wonder though, because I'm really interested in the kind of scale of rough sleeping across Scotland, and while we don't have that kind of common monitoring approach and could do the benefit from one, what we'd be able to count in Glasgow was 1,134 individual people. So that's over 1,000 individual people slept rough in Glasgow at least once. Now they won't all still be home, still be rough sleeping, but that was the count over the course of a single year. Now the HL1 count within Glasgow was about 300 or 400 people. So there's a significant difference between how many rough sleepers are caught through HL1 monitoring, because the question is so limited. The question is about how many people slept rough last. Did you sleep rough last night? That's what the question is. And if you did, you capture it. And if you didn't, you don't. And it doesn't capture people that go into sleep rough that night, or people that maybe slept rough the previous week. And our common monitoring which strips out all the duplicates, so we are talking about individual people, doesn't put that kind of category round about it. What it doesn't do is deduplicate with what the local authority is counting. So what it means that we're also able to say that 1100 number is an absolute minimum, and it could be plus what the council counts, or at least a proportion of what the council counts. So I suspect if we were to extrapolate that across the other cities in some way, a formula somewhere within that, if you looked at kind of Edinburgh, Dundee, Fife, Aberdeen being the key areas where they're sleeping after Glasgow would occur, and other areas too, we might get closer to what the national scale might be.
Plays a different picture. It does seem to be the larger towns and the cities.
Absolutely.
And elsewhere, Mr Nelson quite heavily painting that it's not the same across the country. It depends in the geography of the country, and that's quite helpful. Ruth, do you want to follow up on some of that?
Yeah, I thank you for those answers. I suppose, you know, today we're trying to decide what we'll look at as a committee, and it's hard to sort of compartmentalise each aspect of it because it is all tied in. So I suppose it's just to ask whether you think there'd be merit in us looking specifically at rough sleeping and potentially solutions to that, or whether we spoke about the additional services that people need, that, you know, the types of accommodation, whether, you know, when we look at all those things, it's going to be caught up in that.
Rough sleeping is the most extreme form of homelessness, and we know this. Homelessness happens more in areas which have the highest economic disadvantage. The single biggest cause of homelessness, even though we look at it in terms of what happens immediately before a person becomes homeless, the structural reasons why people come homeless is, of course, poverty. And that's the single biggest reason, you know. Mm-hmm. So if we look at rough sleeping in those terms, if we're looking at rough sleeping as a strategy or a focus, absolutely, but within the context of Housing First, I would plead. Because Housing First is the only, it's the most evaluated, evidenced solution to the group that we're talking about here. There simply isn't another solution that's ever been researched or evaluated that produces better outcomes for people sleeping rough than the Housing First approach. If the Housing First approach is implemented using all the criteria to ensure fidelity to the model, because you'll get greater outcomes then. If you don't get the right sort of support, then it doesn't work. But if you do, it does.
Thank you.
We've begun to look more within Scotland at multiple or complex needs rather than rough sleeping, because you do have this kind of potentially this kind of revolving door of people, you know, some of the people you're potentially talking about who go into tenancies and then it fails for whatever reason, and then they're on the streets or whatever. We work with a lot of people in Edinburgh who are in and out of B&Bs and that kind of thing, and I think so there's something about understanding who we're talking about with rough sleeping, which goes back to your original point. And then there's something about who those people are and tackling those things. And I think probably a lot of that is complex needs. There may be something specifically around immigrants and that kind of thing, the support that they get. And what happens if you are here? I mean, one of the situations I've heard a couple of people mention is where you've got couples from an Eastern Europe or somewhere like that, and there's domestic violence, and then the couple splits up, and the woman has no history of working here, she has very little English potentially, and she's in a very vulnerable situation, and she's not entitled to any housing benefit and so on. So what happens in those sorts of situations? So there's something I think about the support that there is available for immigrants, and I, you know, recognise that's not necessarily within purview of this parliament. But then there's also the complex needs. There's unpicking what rough sleeping is, and then I think there's the complex needs issue. I would agree with Maggie about Housing First. You know, it is a very well-evidenced approach. We have to make sure we stick to the model. I think some things are called Housing First, which are just a house and no support, and that doesn't work. You know, we're talking about really, you know, people with very complex needs. And I think if you look at Turning Point Scotland, who they piloted it Housing First within the UK in Glasgow, and they've done some really interesting work, and talking to some of the people and to the staff working with them, you know, they've helped some really people who have very challenging needs and who've been sleeping rough for very long periods and stuck with them as they go into housing, and then they've, you know, they've gone back to living on the streets for a bit, and then they've gone back to housing, then they've gone back to living on the streets, and then finally they've begun to maintain that tenancy and keep going with it.
Okay, thanks, Ruth. I know that you're going to explore temporary accommodation, or if you want to run with that now, or because it leads in quite nicely, I think, just in terms of we're talking about housing first, but there has to be supply, and whether that's a permanent tenancy initially or temporary accommodation, I know there's issues around that, and I know Ruth was going to explore some of the areas around that.
I suppose it's, it's really the whole thing in terms of temporary accommodation. The challenges around the suitability, and these are things that we have heard a bit about from some of you, how we can improve homeless persons' experience of that. We had a visit to Streetworks in Edinburgh and heard about people's experience in B&Bs, which wasn't particularly positive. And I think, you know, even without complex needs or vulnerabilities, would be actually quite hard to live that way. And I think, Beth, you spoke about the impact of welfare reform and funding on temporary accommodation. So just your reflections on that, on the whole thing, really.
I mean, I guess in terms of the broader picture, we've got about 10,000 people in bed in temporary accommodation at any one time in Scotland, and that number's got pretty static over the last few years. But what we do know is that the length of time in that accommodation is increasing. Now, there's a whole range of types of accommodation that people might be in. As a crisis, we're particularly concerned about people who are in unsuitable accommodation. We've said that families can be in unsuitable accommodation, which often means bed and breakfast, although it can mean other kind of accommodation which doesn't necessarily have the right facilities for long-term living. We see in Edinburgh, we see people there for kind of 18 months at a time in some cases, and there are a number of parts of Scotland where that is the case. We've said that's not suitable for families. We think that should be really, if accommodation's unsuitable, it's unsuitable for anybody. It's right that we prioritise families, but actually we need to be looking really at everybody who's homeless. And, there are some local authorities who've made, a lot of local authorities have made some really good progress towards ending the use of B&B. Fife have done a lot of work recently. Renfrewshire as well have done a lot of work to end the use of bed and breakfast. So I guess there's the point about the suitability of temporary accommodation and particularly bed and breakfast type accommodation. And I think from a Glasgow perspective, some of the traditional hostel approaches, and obviously there's talk about the Belgrove Hotel on a regular basis, which is utterly unsuitable. There's the length of stay. And I think in terms of the length of stay in temporary accommodation, it's about can we get people into permanent accommodation much faster. You know, the affordable housing programme, you know, will contribute to that. We should be looking at the private rented sector. You know, can we use prevention approaches to help people stay in accommodation where that's appropriate? So whether that's young people facing family relationship difficulties, it might be that you can facilitate that and with some mediation. It's not always going to be appropriate, and we need to be aware of forcing young people back into accommodation which isn't appropriate for them. But in some cases that can be sustained, especially if you get there early enough. And then there's the wider question, which is the funding of temporary accommodation. And I think that's a really big challenge. I've heard various estimates of the shortfall each year that's going to be in temporary accommodation. But I do think that also provides an opportunity to rethink what we're doing. You know, we are going to have to look at this, and we're going to have to say, well, actually, how can we do this differently? So can we use some of the options I've set out to do that differently? Or, you know, can we convert some of the private sector leasing to short tenancies? Or, you know, can we think differently and do something more imaginative around this?
I agree with that. It almost kind of feels like we're at a crossroads now, and it is either, you know, whether we make better the wrong system or create the right system, and I think that's where a number of people's discussions have arrived at, and clearly, at least in my opinion, what we want to do is start creating the right system. The temporary accommodation is such a central plank of our current homelessness system, and it continues to grow, you know. That we start then needing to want to improve it, because that's what we do, and that's what we're here for. We look at people's homelessness and particularly complex forms of it, and in all its complexity, and start applying more and more responses to that because it feels like the right thing to do. They're not necessarily coordinated responses. And ultimately what we're doing is we're creating additional layers and layers and layers on top of an already very complicated system. And if instead what we can do is start unpeeling those layers and taking it back to a great quote I heard the other day, which is when we stop looking at homelessness as a homelessness system and instead look at it as a rehousing system, then everything changes. And I think I absolutely fundamentally believe in that, that in attempting to alleviate people's suffering, we've instead unintentionally prolonged their experience. And if we can bring it right back to the simple fact that homelessness is not only a housing issue, but it's always a housing issue. And if we can start from that place and apply all the supports that people need, then it'll progress us further.
Can I give a really obvious example of that, I think, is people leaving prison. You know, when people go into prison, we know when they're going to leave. So why are they ending up going through the homelessness system? And why are they in temporary accommodation for however long? And, you know, and then while they're waiting to get somewhere else, you know, we should be able to get that journey right. And I think that's a really obvious example of something that's kind of buried deeper in the system. You know, we could be looking at housing first for, you know, if somebody's coming out of prison, relatively complex needs, they need stability. You put them in housing first, you get the right support in place for them. They won't have to move after 6 months or 12 months or whatever. And, you know, But again, that goes back to having some sort of coordinated approach, a strategy. Crisis is doing some work in Liverpool, which is looking at a regional approach for housing first in that city region. And, you know, it's about, like Maggie says, you know, having a really coordinated approach to that. You're doing some work in Glasgow as well, looking at that in the private rented sector as well. You know, how can we think a bit differently and make sure that we sort out the housing first rather than saying, well, you have to go through this homelessness route that we've created.
The solutions that we know are cheaper and more effective, and yet we're not doing them to scale. And it's that we have this amazing opportunity in front of us. You know, there are other aspects of resolving homelessness, that there are lots of different approaches. And what we also need to do is kind of really frame in, narrow in on what works and do that in quite a systematic way, and be working with Crisis on that type of approach as well. But we do need to simplify and deduplicate the system, and we'll get further ahead.
And we know that the costs are huge, but the costs aren't necessarily to the homeless services, the costs are to the A&E services, the costs are to the criminal justice service, the police, you know, to the mental health services. And that is one of the problems. And we did some costing, you know, to prevent somebody's homelessness. We looked at four different scenarios. Typically cost about £1,500 for a person. Now, if that person doesn't get support, they go on to, you know, worst case scenario, go into rough sleep, you know, mental health problems, involvement in criminal justice, that can be £10,000 in a year easily. You know, so if we can get this right, there's huge savings to public purse, but it does potentially require some upfront investment.
Ruth, do you want to add anything?
Thank you.
In a moment, I'm going to bring in Andy Whiteman for another line of questioning, but can I just... there's a question wrapped up in here, but I want to make sure that my observation's valid, because I want to have captured this right. So I'm talking as a constituency MSP now, and some of my experiences in the past is when various vulnerable people get put in temporary accommodation, it's temporary furnished, they may sustain that, they may not sustain that. Now, the nature of vulnerable people is quite often they don't sustain it, and with all the antisocial manifestations that can bring, where I will have other constituents complain to myself about antisocial or problem tenants, which stigmatises the homelessness case. Now, the irony for myself is when a tenant does get put in that temporary furnished accommodation and they make a success of that tenancy, they still get moved on. And actually, it's not just unfair on the tenant who's made a success of that tenancy, it's unfair on the neighbours that are sharing a landing or are close with that tenant, because another vulnerable tenant gets moved in who might not sustain the tenancy. And I've got constituents who, in the longer term, have a kind of yo-yo effect of vulnerable tenants getting moved in and moved out. And even when they make a success of it, they don't get allowed to stay. So I'm just wondering if housing first options may not just be best financially in terms of how we use budgets, best for the homeless person, but also best for the neighbours in the community as well.
I just, any comments on that would be quite helpful. Have I captured that correctly?
Yeah, I think you've captured it perfectly. I think that's my experience. You know, someone, as Beth was saying, someone could be in a temporary accommodation that's partly furnished, but they feel it is a home because it's partly furnished and it's more comfortable than moving into somewhere new where they've not got any funds to actually make it a home. And it is about developing relationships. And it's back to what I think I mentioned earlier, that if we really, really want to aim, in which we all are, to end homelessness, we really need to integrate people that have been homeless for a long period of time that are suffering from a lot of issues back into the community. And the community needs to play a part in that. And what you're just saying there is exactly that, that a lot of individuals, or one individual, could stigmatise or change the perceptions of the public to the next 20, 30, 40 people that are in that community. And to change that, it's about a coordination. It's actually about sitting and thinking. I think what something about Margaret Anne was saying, and in my experience, there seems to be a fear factor in making decisions. It's like, you know, right, this structure has been in place for the social work department for 10 years. Its outcomes is this, and we look at that, but there's, you know, maybe constructive criticism of it's not working effectively or it's not working properly, we can maybe tweak it here, but there's a fear factor where it's amongst the seniors or the managers of that to say, well, if we state that it needs changed now, we might be criticised for it being that way for the last 5 years. I'm trying to say that there's a fear factor. There's a fear factor within the third sector of losing your job, losing your funding. So there's anxiety levels round about that and stress. There's fear factor of criticising the person that is giving you the funding. And I also think within the statutory sector, there's a fear factor because the structures have been in place and we need to start changing the structures. We need to actually have a coordinated effort. We're looking at integration of healthcare, we're looking at integration of social care, but there's still this protective arm from certain agencies around certain parts of those organisations. That's natural, I understand it.
I feel so bad for cutting you off, Mr.
No, you do. I ramble on as I say so.
I mean yeah. Perhaps I'm rambling on with my question, so I'm just as bad, but I just want to make sure that the picture that I'm painting is not just unique to a couple of constituents cases I've had over the last couple of years, but it's perhaps, is it something, Margaret and Beth, that you think you've experienced when you've tried to help and support vulnerable individuals sustain tenancies?
I think there's something really important about valuing social relationships and social networks, and I think for a lot of the people that we work with, that is critical. And you know, the end of homelessness is you get a social tenancy, that's kind of ideal, but actually for a lot of the people we work with, they get the social tenancy, there's no furniture, it's right on the edge of Edinburgh, they don't know anybody there, they have to get a bus a long way to meet any of their friends, and then they have to build all these links with these neighbours who, you know, they may or may not get to know, and I think that's really critical. I think it plays all the way through the homelessness system, actually. If we're talking about people with complex needs, we know that for a lot of those people, there's increasing evidence to show that trauma early in childhood and all the way through life can make a big difference. So building relationships and having consistent relationships, and I know this is going slightly away from your point, but is really important. And, you know, I think some of the things that Eddie was saying around the length of time you can work with people, actually, for some people, it will take 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 years to build up a relationship where they feel that they can trust. So I think if you're moving people from temporary accommodation into somewhere, moving them on constantly in that journey, then they have no opportunity to really put some roots down. And actually those, you know, there's the issue of around stigma with neighbours, but there's also the issue of they'll keep an eye out for you and check that you're okay and that, you know, your mental health hasn't gone down and that, you've actually left your house in the last 2 weeks, you know, all those kind of things as well. Those social networks are really important, and I think we need to find a way of valuing them more in the services that we provide.
And that was my experience, where neighbours actually wanted the individual to stay within the stairwell and the close because they were a good neighbour and they couldn't work out why that would be temporary accommodation, because that accommodation was suitable for that person, and they'd put down roots and the system just seemed crazy that then they would move that person on. But I think you articulate it a lot better than I did, Beth. Do you want to add anything to that, Margaret?
I mean, exactly what you're saying, and I'll make it very quick, that there is definitely more that we can do within that period when people are temporarily accommodated, particularly when that temporary accommodation is provided as a flat through RSLs or a local authority, depending on your kind of local context. We're missing opportunities there. People are there often prolonged periods of time instead of being given the opportunity to lay down roots and for the life to stop being on hold. It's always considered as a temporary stay, even though that temporary is often quite long term. Instead, if one of the more creative solutions we can be looking at is whether those flats, where it fits the aspirations of the household, whether those flats can be converted to permanent accommodation. If you're there temporarily, you know, can that secure tenancy just be applied to the same tenancy so that people can get on with their lives, you know?
That might only swallow in the cases, yeah. But that's been my experience. Thank you very much. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of questions. One quite short one here. Beth, you talked earlier about a degree of confusion as to whether someone, in fact, has actually presented as homeless with local authorities. There was quite a well-publicised case here in Parliament of a gentleman who was campaigning on a point similar to that, asking that there should be a statutory right to declare as homeless. Is that something that you recognise as not being there? And if it's not, should be there? And would that help? Or how, alternatively, can we get a better framework so that people who have a right to declare as homeless are actually getting the response that they deserve?
I wonder if it's a question about transparency within the system. Okay. What's happening at the moment is, I think, that people go to the council. They don't necessarily know the full range of their rights, but they know that if they go to the council, they can get help, hopefully. Not everybody does that. But do they get informed that you have made a homelessness application and this is the outcome of it? You know, do they get told that very clearly or not? And if somebody goes to the council and says, I'm homeless, and they say, well, OK, you can make it, these are your housing options, and you can make a statutory housing a homelessness application, and then they say, well, I want to do that, and then they get told, OK, you've done that, this you will hear within so many days or whatever, then, you know, that's about having a transparent system, I think. So anybody can make a homelessness application, you know, that's, and then if you do that, you go through that kind of statutory process. But they need to know that they've done that, and they need to know what the outcome of that is. You know, it shouldn't be that we're working with a member for 4 months, and at the end of that we call the shelter legal advice line, and then they say, well, actually, the council's saying you haven't made a homelessness application. It shouldn't be that opaque.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thanks very much. Again, this is actually a quick question, but we've heard evidence from Alacho suggesting that the 1987 legislation is outdated. Beth, you've talked about Welsh legislation and English legislation that's going through at the moment. Do you think in broad terms, and I'm not inviting you to get into the detail of it, but do you think in broad terms there's a need to update or amend our homelessness legislation in this session of Parliament?
I'm not going to argue with Tony Kane. However, the 77 legislation was significantly amended by the 2001 and 2003 Acts. I mean, they weren't small amendments. They were significant rewritings of the central tenets of the legislation that resulted in a number of additional rights on people. I can't see that there's any specific new legislation we need. I think we need to be better for all the reasons that we just talked about, better working together and exploring the common ground that we have across all the different sectors to implement what we have. I believe that we have the resources and the legislation that we require to go on with it. We just need to better go on with it. And I'm not sure legislation is what we need next.
Beth, did you want to add anything to that?
I think we have some of the most progressive rights on homelessness in the world. So I would be nervous about anything that might put that at risk. Having said that, I do think there is something that we need to sort out, whether it's legislatively or otherwise, about how we do prevention and how we make sure that people aren't... that we prevent it as early as possible. And I think that there is, as I've said, I think there is a little bit of a tension between housing options and the statutory route at the moment. Now, I'm not saying that necessarily needs a legislative intervention, but I think it does need to be looked at in a bit more detail. And I do think potentially there is something around engaging other services, again, whether that's a legislative route or not, but I think that, you know, we should be looking at the Wales and now the England legislation that's going through and seeing what lessons should we be learning from that and looking at that in quite some detail.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Alexander Stewart.
Can I now move on to the role that the health sector plays within homelessness? Now, we're aware, and we've already discussed, that some of these individuals have complex health issues. They may have mental health issues. But it's how we work together. And there have been some very good partnership processes and partnership working that's taken place. So it would be good to get your views on sort of evidence of partnership working. And is there any focus that we can do more? Is there opportunities for further partnership working to happen within health? Or do we feel that we've taken it to a level and we need to do something radically different if we're going to try and change the whole health agenda? Because, as I say, these individuals do have complex problems and they repeat the problem. It doesn't necessarily go away. It may diminish for a time, and it's only through the partnership working that maybe has happened. But it's how we sustain that and look at what we can do more within that sector, because we got the feeling that there was maybe some gaps still within that sector.
And I think you unfortunately don't have today as Dr. Neil Hamlet, who would have answered your question with precision. I mean, I think what's clear, what Neil has achieved over the last period is in absolutely putting the kind of health, housing, social work components back together again. And in a sense, some of that, probably at a kind of strategic level, had been lost a while. Since the end of the monitoring required round about health and homelessness standards that we had under previous approaches. Some interesting work that we know is kicking off, I think all local authorities have signed up to this, is data linkage. So actually linking health data with local authority HL1 homelessness data, which will allow a much more sophisticated analysis and understanding of the complexity and depth of need, including health need, of people that are coming into the homelessness system. What we would want to try and ensure within that programme is a programme that recognises that what that will do is continue to describe the problem better, which is incredibly important. But similarly, probably a proportionate same amount of effort on, well, what do we do now that we can better describe the problem, do you know? So about real pragmatic responses, solutions, finding out what works and making them work. I am constantly in my mind reminded of a tweet somebody that experiences homelessness, who on the launch of a new homelessness report they were saying, well, how many times do you need to research this? And it's not hard for any of us to want to take that close to what it is we're doing and say, okay, we describe the problem, what now do we put in place to make people's lives easier, you know.
Anyone else want to comment in relation to the link with health and better working that Alexander Stewart was mentioning?
I think that there has been positives in the integrated health and social care. There is moves forward with that. I think it's a slow process because of the nature of the resources that they both have to deal with and the issues that they have. What we feel as a third sector organisation is sometimes our voice isn't heard in relation to if we are taking an individual or supporting an individual to a mental health service or the GP. It sometimes depends on the individual, the professional that we're dealing with. It depends on the history of the individual that's been presenting with that issue. And it's trying to get to an overall picture, and it's back to what I said earlier, that I feel that if an organisation, Beth and Mira has seen, is if we're working with an individual over a period of time, we've got more opportunities to observe the behaviour and the reactions to certain processes they support with that individual. And sometimes that's not taken account in my personal experience when we're supporting an individual and trying to explain to the professional that this is the behaviour that's being displaced with us, displayed when he's with us or whenever with us, and it's not taking into account of decisions made. There's also, because I think the lack of resources within those fields, there is a huge waiting time. And that time is very, very difficult for us as an organisation to support someone through that, because we don't have the experience and the knowledge to take that forward, and that's why we try to signpost and refer individuals on. And again, it's back to, I think, it's what we are saying, hopefully collectively, that it's more a coordination of effort, it's more a coordination of services, and it's really about communication. That's what I feel is we need to communicate better, we need to communicate more, and actually start listening a little bit more too.
I'd agree with those points. I think in terms of service delivery, and particularly for thinking about people with complex needs, and I think this came up in your previous evidence session, but you know, when we're talking about people with quite chaotic lives and so on, there's something about recognising how those people are going to engage with your service, because they are not going to be able to adapt to your service structure. And you know, remember that you've got an appointment in a month's time on a 9 o'clock on a Tuesday morning. And you know, so that there is something also about making sure that services meet the needs. And there's a place, there's a Hunter Street in Glasgow, and there's the Access Practice in Edinburgh, and you know, there's places that do that. I think perhaps there's challenges in more rural areas and so on about that. But there is something about thinking about how can we support this person to engage, particularly, I think, with mental health services. Not for any criticism of mental health services, but people with mental health problems will have difficulties engaging, and that's their problem. There's a guy, a psychiatrist from the Access Practice, who speaks very, very eloquently on this. I can't remember his name just off the top of my head, but you know, he talks about their way of engaging is not to engage, because that is their experience of life. People haven't engaged with them, whether that's parents, whether that's people at school and so on. So I think there is something about awareness in some of those services, and perhaps capacity and ability to engage in a different way with some of these clients.
You hit the nail on the head. The capacity is still a vital issue and a problem that we face, and funding comes with that mm-hmm. package. And for some individuals who've been institutionalised and are coming back into the community, they need that step up or that step down to manage their chaotic lifestyle. And you and your agencies are all trying to provide that. But if we're still having a barrier with the health professional, and that could be the community mental nurse, or it could be the GP, or it could be individuals within the sector, then the chain gets broken. And it's very difficult to then put that link back in, because they end up not going to the practice or not going to the appointment, and then they end up going back into another cycle, and that then creates even more problems for the individual.
Back to the strategic approach and the work that Neil Hamlet's doing about saying, well, actually, these people are still coming to the health services. They are costing us a lot of money. Let's get that in an early stage, and actually, if we intervene at that stage and allow them some flexibility, okay, they haven't turned up to this appointment again, but it's a lot cheaper than a psychiatric admission or you know, whatever it might be.
Thank you.
Margaret, and of course I'll let you in. We're almost at the end of our evidence session, but yes, please continue.
To absolutely agree with your point in terms of accessing mainstream services, particularly when people have experience of specialist homelessness services, where they're getting a great service and an immediate service, and then the difference then when you move into the community and the mainstream services that they're not getting that. Glasgow, just as a point of interest, Glasgow took the decision to include homelessness within its health and social care integration as a priority group, which means there is a specific integrated strategic planning group that looks at homelessness, and that's early days, but an interesting approach in terms of making sure that the different aspects are looked at together.
Okay. Thank you. Now, I'm looking at my MSP colleagues if there's any additional questions at this point. I should say, in relation to how health connects with homelessness and service provision, a few of you mentioned Dr. Neil Hamlet, and Dr. Neil Hamlet had hoped to make it today, but he was unable to do so. He's put in his apologies. He's consultant in public health medicine, NHS Fife, and we're still keen to get information from Dr. Hamlet. We think some of his information will be vital. We'll make sure as a committee that we still do that. But it's only reason for anyone watching to put on record Dr. Hamlet did want to be here today, but he was unable to make it. Can I thank all of you for coming along this morning? I feel at certain stages, and this was to the strength of the evidence session, it was a discussion between the three of you and what had to happen to improve the situation, which is kind of what we were looking for. That's a strong evidence session, so we've got a lot out of it. I hope you certainly all have as well. Normally at this stage, I would say to you, and I would say to you, I'm going to ask you to email me or write to me the answers to this. If you were sitting in our position, what questions would you ask when you do a call for evidence? Because we've now taken a lot of fact-finding visits, we've taken a lot of evidence on the record, including today, And we are going to do a formal and detailed call for evidence in relation to the inquiry in homelessness, but we want to make sure it's like Eddie was saying about measuring outcomes and outputs. You have to ask the right questions at the start and the outset of an inquiry to make sure the outcome we get as a committee is appropriate. So any thoughts you've got, if you were sitting in our position, of what you would ask, we'd be very keen to know. But don't tell us just now, because time is upon us. All that remains me to do is to thank our three witnesses and do stay in contact. We'll stay in contact with yourself. And that ends agenda item one. Thank you all. And we now move to agenda item two. Thank you. In fact, we'll suspend briefly just to give our witnesses the opportunity to leave. Thank you.